Welcome to Pure Experiences. We continue the reading and commentary on Shiv Sutras. 23. Madhyavar Prasav. Inferior generation in the space between, which means nothing to me. He does not experience the state of God consciousness in the center of these three states, which also means nothing. The word Prasav means conception, delivery. Avar is inferior. Madhye is in the middle. So in the middle, there is a lower kind of conception, birth. No attempt is made to explain what is the middle, what is the conception. My immediate understanding would be that one stays in the middle of inferior births, that is trapped in the cycle of births and deaths. About this, the Malini Vijaya Tantra says, due to the impressions what others think of him or expect from him and of his wanting to help others, to satisfy them with boons, he may lose his temper and become careless and uneven-minded, blocking his flow of God consciousness from the center of the three states of waking, dreaming and deep sleep. So although he is aware of God consciousness in the beginning and in the end, he is played by this universe in the center, played by hunger, played by thirst, played by the every aspect of daily life. Therefore, the one who desires to achieve the highest being should not be attached to these outer impressions. These impressions are keeping him from the center. If he does not have these thoughts, then his God consciousness will flow throughout, in the beginning, in the end, and in the center. This has already been explained in previous sutras. Matra swa pratyaya sandhane nashtasya punaruthanam. In the act of uniting one's own conception of measures is the act of rising again of the lost. When a yogi in coming out of from samadhi also attempts to maintain awareness of God consciousness in the objective world, then even though his real nature of self is destroyed by the inferior generation of self-consciousness, he again rises in the supreme nature of the self. So I think it is a pretty good description of what is being said in this sutra. But it will be difficult to get a word-to-word meaning of this because an attempt has been made here to do a literal translation which looks like complete gibberish. Punaruthanam is rising again. Nasht is destruction. Swapratyaya will be the idea of the self or the ground of the self. Sandhan is the union. So my understanding here would be something similar, that it is possible to rise again even after the ground of the self is lost. Shivatulyo jayate, he becomes like Shiva. That is very clear. Sharir vritti vratam, maintenance of the body is a holy practice. That is also very clear. Katha jap, conversation is mantra recitation. And here it says that the ordinary talk of life is the recitation of mantra, which essentially may mean that through the body, speech and thought, the seeker embodies this spiritual knowledge. It shows up in his daily life. If it is not showing up in your behavior, daily life and speech and thought, then the spiritual knowledge is merely a curiosity, a story that you heard somewhere. There is no conviction there and there is no faith on it. It is uncertain and unknown. Danam atmam jnanam, the act of giving his self-knowledge. I think that is wrong translation. His only purpose for remaining in his body is to impart his knowledge to others. That is much more meaningful. And my understanding would be that his donation is nothing except dissemination of self-knowledge. Atmajnanam is the self-knowledge. Danam is the donation. He does not donate money or stuff, not accumulating his donation. But he has accumulated knowledge, so he donates it away, gives it away. That becomes the sole purpose of being alive, like here it says. It has been added here, but that is true. Yo vipastho gya hetuscha, he who is engaged in guarding sheep and the cause of knowing. I have no idea how the sheep came in between here. Here it says that the one who rules the wheel of energies becomes the cause of inserting knowledge in others. So this one is half correct, according to my understanding. Gya hetuscha may be translated as cause and cause of knowledge, and Sa will be established abiding. So it is safe to say that he becomes a cause of knowledge in this way. So if you take this other meaning instead of the sheep of Avi, it says kindly disposed. So because of his kindness, he becomes the cause of knowledge for others. So Shakti Prachayo Vishwam, the multitude of his own power is all pervading. For him, this universe is the embodiment of his collective energies, which is poetically meaningful somewhat. Yes. So Shakti will be self-power. Vishwam is the world. And if you take the meaning of Prachay as accumulation, heap, mass, quantity, many, then it does make a little bit of sense that the world is seen as expression of my own powers. Sthitilayo, maintenance of life and dissolution. This universe is the expansion of his energy in objective impressions and in the dissolution of those impressions. So, sthit means stable. Layo means dissolution. So, this creation, maintenance and dissolution is the function of these energies, the Shakti. There is a lot of explanation given here in this book, The Spiritual Awakening, which is trying to find similar sounding of similar meaning content in other scriptures, which throw some light on the original sutra. Right now I'm skipping through them because it is a repetition of what we have already discussed. Tat pravitta vip nirasa samvetri bhavat. Also, without exclusion, this world and acting are both from the character of one who has consciousness. Although he is determined in creating, protecting and destroying the universe, even then he is not separated from the real state of his subjectivity. This one is a little bit difficult to understand because there are so many new words for me. For example, aniras and samvitru. The rest can be translated a little. I'm not going to bother about this. Sukha sukhyo bahirmananam. Pleasure and pain is outward thinking. He experiences his joy and his sadness just like an object with this consciousness separate from his being. That is very clear. The sukha suk means joy and sadness, and bahirmananam means it is seen as an outside object. Mananam will be the thinking part, is seen as thought objects, not me, not my states. Tadvi muktastu kevali. But freed from this world is one devoted to the doctrine of the absolute unity of spirit. Separated from pleasure and pain, he is established in real seclusion. Yes. This one is a much better interpretation in my view. The dvi means these two that we discussed, the sadness and the joy. Mukta means free. Kevali means unity, oneness. Or you can say aloneness, seclusion, yes. So having been freed from the duality, he is now stabilized in the non-duality. Moha prati sanhatastu karmatma. But one whose character is action is towards forming one mass of delusion. The yogi whose God consciousness is destroyed by this state of illusion is dependent on his action. So my understanding would be that the one who thinks I am the doer is now in the grip of attachments. Bhed tiraskare sargantar karmatvam. In the disappearance of the act of distinction is the state of action of another creation of the world. He drives away the field of differentiated perceptions and enter into a new world of God consciousness. So, tiraskar may mean abandoning, letting go. Bhed is the differentiation. Sarg may mean many things, but it may mean a very heavenly world. So, it is a bit difficult to translate here. This one says the Sanskrit word tiraskare, which I am rendering as drives away, does not mean he totally ignores this differentiated perception. Here drives away indicates that he ignores it through the mind. Although internally he does everything that other individuals do, he is not attached to those differentiated perceptions. So although he lives in these differentiated perceptions, the nature of his God consciousness shines forth and these perceptions subside. Then successively he enters into these worlds. So Swachhanda Tantra says that he becomes so great, he terrifies Brahma, Vishnu and the Indra, the Siddhas, the Daitya and those who rule the great deities, Garuda. So it will be sufficient to say that the life changes completely. Karan Shakti Swato Anubhavat. The power of producing is from one's own experience. And here it says that the power of creation is the experience of every individual. People may not agree with it, but I would say this, the sutra here may mean that he comes to know by his own experience that he is the cause, he is the power behind the creation. Tripadadadya Anupranam. Beginnings of the three parts is after the act of animating. Emerging from the state of Turiya, insert the absolute bliss of that state into the waking, dreaming and deep sleep states, and they will become one with the state of Turiya. This may mean in simple words that the three states are seen as animation of the prana, the energies. He remains in the fourth state while witnessing the three states as play of the pranic energies. Chittasthiti vacharikaran bahayoshu. In the outer of the organs of sense of the body is like being in the state of mind. The awareness of God consciousness should only be infused in that state where one's mind is established in one-pointedness, but it should also be infused in the establishment of his body, in his organic actions, and in the external objective world. So this makes it really clear that the chittasthiti or the state of the mind should penetrate the body and external world, the family or society. And when I say should, it actually will. It happens by itself. The bliss is radiated. Don't need to do too much effort. Abhilapad bahirgati samvah. Yes. From expression is the extroversion of the to be carried. Due to the insatiable and insistent desire to fill that gap in his nature, his flow and movement are towards the objective world, not subjective consciousness, and so he is carried from one birth to another. So Abhilapat may be translated as under the influence of desires. Bahirgati is extroverted movement, and this word is very difficult for me, which is translated as to be carried or born, which here Shyam Raja agrees with, so let's take it. And now the meaning is clear, that the desires will carry you outwards into the maya, into the illusion. Tadarud pramite stha shaya jiva sanshaya. From the destruction of this world, of the manifestation brought to this world, is the complete destruction of life. No. That's all desire vanishes in that fortunate person whose consciousness is established in his own real nature. For him, the state of being a limited individual has ended. Yes. Tadarud may mean thus rising above. Pramita Shaya may mean destruction of all the notions. And Jeev Sankshaya means again destruction. So the Jeev or the causal body or the individual is destroyed. When you are high up there in the self-knowledge, you have become the Shiv. Now the Jeev goes away completely, is gone. So although there can be more meanings of what appears there in the sutra, but as you can notice, these are simpler versions of what we have already discussed. Bhut Kanchuki Tadha Vimukto Bhuya Patisampara. The snake of the world, which has recently cast its skin, is then again like the Supreme Lord. For him, the five elements are only coverings. At that very moment, he is absolutely liberated, supreme, and just like Shiva. So let's go from the bottom. Para is the highest, beyond. Patisam means just like the owner, just like the master. Vibhukto Bhuya means becoming liberated. And Bhut Kanchuki is shedding the skin like a snake. So what is this shedding of coverings? It is the coverings of ignorance, obviously. And then becomes free and becomes just like the highest, the supreme. Naisargika prana sambandha. The connection with the breath of life is inherent. This connection with breathing in and breathing out is his nature. So I can only say that this is right. And the prakriti, which is here mentioned as the nisarg, is related to the consciousness through the vehicle of, through the mechanism of the prana energies. And I think he means to say that, understand this, it is natural. And this will be there for a liberated person also. It is very natural to get associated with the life. This book goes into depth of the prana shakti and all. For those who are interested, nasikant madhyasayamat kimmatra savyapasya vayo sushumneshu. From the control of the senses of the internal middle of the nose, what is in this respect in the sushumna channel on the left and right, which I don't really understand. If his consciousness is established in the central vein, in that force, which is the energy of life, then he remains always the same. For him, there is no difference in traveling in prana, apana or sushumna. So, the staying in the middle may mean staying in the samadhi. And then it is said that the life energies flow in the middle channel, which is called the sushumna. And when that happens, the other stuff does not matter. It can be induced through proper breathing. The book introduced us to the anulom vilom kind of practice in the last part, I think, which tries to balance the nervous system so that the consciousness is centered in the middle. Middle means not in complete trance and not in complete extroverted state. So it seems to be asking a question which I cannot understand. Bhuya sthapat syat prati milanam. Again, one should be towards closing the eyes. This yogi simultaneously and repeatedly experiences the revealing state and the concealing state of the objective world. This is well said in the Swachanda Tantra, O Goddess. There is one state which is beyond the state of Unmana, into which one should direct his consciousness. And when one's self is absolutely directed into that state, he becomes one with that state. When fire, which has arisen from wood, has become absolutely pure, filled with glamour and shining with flames, it does not again enter into that wood in the same way. When the self has separated itself from the differentiated perception of the universe, it does not again get entry into that differentiated universe. In the sutra, this word bhuya repeatedly means he gets the consciousness of the world in and out again and again. The world appears as if it has arisen inside and then it again merges in his own self. And this happens over and over again, not once, not twice, but repeatedly. This is the purpose of saying that for this yogi, the state of being Shiva is not fresh or new. It has not appeared for the first time. The state of being Shiva is already his nature. So practicing in this way, repeatedly taking it out and then bringing it back to your own nature, is intended for knowing this very state of being. So it is somewhat clear now that the world appears repeatedly to the one who is in the state of Shiva. And it looks like that it was my own nature always, even if it happens repeatedly. So here ends the third awakening. The conclusion says, I have placed this commentary on the Shiva Sutra before the public because it is adorned with references from the Agamas and the Spanda Shastra. For the sake of destroying the differentiated perception of this universe, let those fortunate persons relish the nectar of the Shiva Sutra commentary of mine, this Shiva Sutra Vimarshini, from which flows the secret of Shiva is filled with that ever-new existent nectar and its essence. The glory of this Shiva Sutra commentary of mine is that it has the power to generate curiosity, to realize Shaivism in the minds of those who have no curiosity. It expands and generates a great change in their intellects. By merely tasting this nectar, the fear of birth, old age and death is removed. The ordinary public, because their consciousness is concealed by the adjustment of the ego on a limited body, in the waking state, the dreaming state, and the state of deep sleep, does not perceive the original state of their God consciousness, which is great and which belongs to Lord Shiva himself. And when, because of the teaching of the Shiv Sutra Vimarshini, that rare soul realizes that this universe is only existing as congealed foam in the ocean of nectar of universal consciousness, then truly he has become one with Lord Shiva. O fortunate ones, may you immediately cross this ocean of sansar and be established and rooted in the supreme state of God consciousness, which is filled with the nectar of eternal light. This Shiv Sutra, which has come from the mouth of Lord Shiva and which is shining with the real secret of his being, will, by the trick of your master, cause you to quickly overcome differentiated universal perception. Here ends the Shiv Sutra Vimarshini. So this was the reading and interpretation of Shiv Sutra. And I hope you enjoyed this series and it was enlightening for everyone. Thank you very much for listening.